My name is Dr. Rajiv Jhangiani, and I'm a psychology instructor at Kwantlen Polytechnic University. Tonight I'm talking about the psychology of good and evil. People like to believe that good things happen to good people and bad things happen to bad people, when we know that's very much not the case. So one thing I hope to explore is the question of what does it take for an ordinary person to become a mass murderer? And the other is what does it take for an ordinary person to decide to risk their life to save that of a complete stranger? I think in exploring these questions, it's important for my students, but also for the interested public, to try and approach the issue, knowing that human behavior is not simple, but the complexity itself shouldn't stop us from trying to understand how we can stop these problems.
My name is Pauline Finn, and I'm the Vice President of Community Engagement here at Science World. I want to thank you all for joining us on this somewhat dark and stormy night for the psychology of good and evil. Tonight's intriguing talk is the fourth in our wonderful series with KPU. So if you didn't get a chance to pick up the flyer, do so, and please join us again for the last two sessions coming up in February. As most of you know, Science World is a charitable not-for-profit organization committed to inspiring future science and technology leadership throughout the province. We do this with our exhibits, our programs, and our outreach. And more, we're experimenting with community partners to combine our efforts to inspire our community with topics, formats, and ideas that we would never tackle on our own. I want to thank KPU for being such a terrific partner, to play around with and experiment with safely, and sometimes not so safely, to help us begin to imagine our geodesic dome here, not just as a place for exhibits and programs, but also a place for creative collaboration where innovation and innovators gather. So thank you all for coming tonight.
Hi everyone, my name's Dr. Diane Purvey and I'm the Dean of Arts at KPU. I'd like to welcome you here tonight. Thank you so much for coming out. And I also want to say a special thank you to Science World. As Pauline just said, it's been a great partnership. It's really fun to work together, and we hope that it's a partnership that will continue over the years. I'd like to recognize that KPU's president, Dr. Alan Davis, is with us tonight. Alan? And I'd also like to acknowledge that the Social Sciences and Humanities Research Council of Canada helped us to support this through providing funding for this series. Each of you received a bag tonight, and in that bag is a survey. If you could fill it out and give it to us before you leave, there'll be a box outside, and at the very bottom of the survey is a little portion where you can fill out and drop it in the box for a prize. As Pauline said, tonight is the fourth installment in the KPU Science World Speaker Series, and I'm really honored to introduce Dr. Rajiv Jhangiani, one of our esteemed faculty members in the psychology department at KPU. Dr. Jhangiani conducts research in political psychology, open education, and the scholarship of teaching and learning. In addition to being a full-time faculty member at KPU, he is an associate editor of Psychology, Learning, and Teaching, an Open Educational Research Fellow with the Open Education Group, a Faculty Fellow with the BC Open Textbook Project, and Director of Research, Resources, and Special Initiatives with the Society for the Teaching of Psychology. Dr. Jhangiani has been with us at KPU for less than 2 years, and already he's established himself as a leader in the Faculty of Arts and across the entire institution. He is engaged, he's brilliant, and he's an enthusiastic faculty member. He's one of those people that people want to follow. And he's also, oftentimes when I meet with Rajiv, he'll give me some ideas and he'll leave and I'll go, wow, that's such a great idea. So he's one of these people who will always wow you, and I'm sure you'll find that tonight. So it was a great pleasure that I introduced him to you.
Wow, thank you. I don't know about you, but I really like that talk much more than what I'm about to give. Just going to take a quick sip over here before we begin. It really is a great pleasure to be here this evening, especially to talk about such an important topic. But before we do, I do want to acknowledge that we are on the traditional territories of the Squamish, Coast Salish, and Tsleil-Waututh First Nations. I also want to thank Kwantlen and, of course, Science World for giving me this opportunity to talk about such an important topic. And it's more than just a pleasure, really, because this is a really meaningful time of the year to be talking about this, the psychology of good and evil. A couple of weeks ago, Hindus across the world celebrated the festival of Dasera, which has to do with marking the triumph of good over evil. In a couple of weeks, they will celebrate Diwali, which is the festival of lights and that marks the start of their new year. But today is also the start of Holocaust Education Week. And a week from today, we will mark and remember the events of Kristallnacht, the night of broken glass, during which a massive coordinated effort was undertaken to target Jews throughout the German Reich in 1938. And of course, we're just over a week from Remembrance Day, and Lord knows we have a lot to remember, but a lot to learn from as well. Tonight's talk will be about the psychology of good and evil. One of the things I hope to address is, what does it take for an ordinary, average person like you or I, with no history of criminal behavior, with no history of psychological disorders, what does it take for you or I to become a mass murderer? But on the flip side, what does it take for an average person like you or I to choose to risk our life and perhaps even the lives of our family to save that of a complete stranger? So at Kwantlen, I teach a course on the psychology of genocide, and I see many of my current and some of my former students here as well. And I mention this because much of my talk tonight will focus on the behavior of perpetrators as well as rescuers in the context of genocide. But before we talk about extraordinary evil, I actually want to spend some time talking about very ordinary, mundane, routine behavior in all of its magnificent absurdity. So I want to start by asking you to consider this particular situation that you've probably been in thousands of times. It's wonderful. As a social psychologist, I'm always interested in how subtle situations that we encounter all the time influence our behavior in ways that we're not necessarily aware of. And this is a terrific example, because as social as we are as a species, an elevator is a bit different. Because let's be honest, we all would prefer to be alone in this particular confined space. Right? Think about it. You press the button, the elevator car appears, the doors open, you walk in, and you press the button as quickly as you can. Often you press the extra button that makes it really shut faster. And then as it's closing, imagine that somebody sticks their hand through the doors. Let's be honest, there's a part of you that dies in that moment, isn't there? So anyway, so they stick their hand in, they come in, the door opens, and they come in. And you let them file in one after the other. And then the doors shut. And this is one of these awkward situations because there are no explicit rules about how we're supposed to behave in an elevator. It's not written on the side of the walls. But it's subtle. It's implicit. And they're very, very strong rules. An elevator is an extraordinarily strong situation, even though it's subtle. So the doors close, and what do? We don't make extensive eye contact with the other people in there. That would be creepy. We have three options. We look at our feet. We look at the doors. Or most popular, I think you'll agree, we look at the changing numbers. Yes? Very popular. So I'm interested, as I said, in subtle situations that have incredibly powerful effects. And an elevator is a great example. But a really good way to discern whether a situation is, in fact, powerful is to start meddling with some of its subtle rules. And so here's what I'm going to encourage you to do the next time you enter an elevator. It's nothing illegal. It's nothing immoral. But wait, you actually want people to come in this time. Let them come in. Let the door shut. And as soon as they do, all you have to do is turn around and face the back. The whole way. Just the whole way. You don't have to look at them. You don't have to talk to them. But you will feel how uncomfortable you're making them. It's wonderful. An elevator is powerful. An audience is incredibly powerful as well. Let's say you've gone with some friends to watch a play or a concert. And again, let's be honest, the performance was mediocre. Okay, but it's opening night and the first three rows are full of the performer's friends and family. And as soon as it finishes, they all leap to their feet to start to deliver a standing ovation, right? And you know that this doesn't merit a standing ovation, right? So you've decided, I'm not going to stand up. But as more and more people start to stand up, you start to feel a little more pressure. And then as every single person in your row is now standing up, now, my God, you think, okay, fine. And you get up and you start doing this. They haven't changed your internal opinion. They haven't changed your attitudes about how good the performance was. They have changed your behavior. It's a powerful situation. One last one. When we cross the street, so you go to the corner, and let's say you live in a place where right now, let's say there's no traffic. There's no cars on the street whatsoever, any direction. You can see for miles, there's no cars. But you're patient and you're polite, and so you press the button and you wait. Right? It's wonderful. You've waited. Now, there's two other people who come along 30 seconds later, and they see you waiting, so they think, okay, let's wait as well. So now there's three of you. A couple of minutes later, there's three more people who come, and it's taking a very long time. But now there's six of you who are waiting patiently and politely. And you know what's going to happen at this point. It's not changing. There's always some moron who comes from the back, isn't it? You know what I'm talking about. They do this, right? They do this. And you think about all the pressure that's been built up by the six people who are standing over there, started by you, that held everybody back like a dam, and the pressure has been released. And it's open season, and all the lunatics are crossing the street now. Yes? You're laughing because it's true. But this example also illustrates a different thing, because all of these examples demonstrate the power of the situation, but this example demonstrates what really is the paradox of social psychology, my discipline. Social psychology is very much about demonstrating the power of the situation, especially subtle situations and the rules that flow from them. But with this last example, you also see how the behavior of one person can actually redefine the situation for everybody, which is quite interesting. Because temporarily now you formed a group wherein the norm is in fact jaywalking, which is quite interesting. So those are all fascinating situations. But let's talk about another. This is not an example of a powerful situation, but this does illustrate how much we refuse to acknowledge the power of the situation. You're driving down the highway, someone cuts you off in traffic, just barely avoids hitting your car. Think about how you react in that moment. It's instant. You don't have to think about it. You're not thinking for a long time. It's an instant reaction. And it's not, bless you, my son. Right? You're not chanting Om or Serenity Now. Some of you got that reference. No. There are, you know, horns are honking, lights are flashing, fingers are waving, curse words are hurling. Or even better, in some cases, there's almost a funny decision that takes place. Think about how wonderful evolution is. If this is the pinnacle, I'm afraid it's not. You just showed me how badly you can drive. Now let me show you how badly I can drive. It's a fascinating decision, the tailgating. But all of this is happening because in that fraction of a second that you've been cut off in traffic, you've actually made an assumption. And the assumption is this person's bad driving, this cutting me off, has been caused by the fact that they are inconsiderate, that they are a jerk, that they are a bad driver. And they very well may be all of those things, but it could also, of course, be that they're rushing to the hospital or some other emergency, but the situation being invisible to us escapes our explanation. And so we tend to focus our explanation on personality, on the individual. And despite the fact that situations are powerful, right? Audiences are powerful, street corners are powerful, elevators are powerful, we refuse to admit their power over us. And so when we explain other people's behaviors, we commit what Lee Ross, famous psychologist, termed the fundamental attribution error. So it's interesting. But more than interesting, there's a reason why I'm talking about ordinary behavior, because I know we're supposed to be talking about good and evil. And it's simple. It's because if you want to understand how a tornado forms, you need to learn how to study normal air currents. What I'm trying to say is that extraordinary evil is often based on an extremely ordinary foundation. And so I want you to think about those moments when perhaps you're driving and you refuse to let somebody pull out from their parking spot because you're in a rush. Or perhaps you refuse, or you said, I'm not going to compost tonight because I'm just one person and what difference would it make? And I'm good a person in every other way. Right? I love having you in this audience. But it gets darker than that as well, doesn't it? When we hear about a woman who's been sexually assaulted, and we have this conversation about wondering out loud about what she was wearing. When we see a homeless person and we get angry in our head thinking about how lazy they are. These are these air currents that help us to explain many things. And if we really think that one of the biggest threats our country faces right now is one woman whose identity has been verified multiple times, who's participating in a purely ceremonial and optional activity wearing a niqab. These are the air currents I'm talking about. But now let's move to talk about the big, the event, the tornado. And I want you to think about what this word means to you. This is amorphous, right? This is big, it's nebulous. I'm not really sure what this means. It means different things to different people. Some people choose to define evil in terms of intention or the action or the outcome of an event, even if it was unintentional. But I'm curious, how many of you think that it's possible to point to a person? It could be a person living now or a historical figure. Is it possible to point to even one person in the history of humanity and say that person was evil? I'm wondering how many of you feel that's okay. It's interesting. I might ask you that again at the end of today's today's class, because that's pretty much what it feels like. But I'm curious. What does evil mean anyway? It's hard to say. I mean, I think you can look at it as you know, deliberate actions with reasonably foreseeable consequences that involve harm. That's one way of approaching it. But another way to look at it is to consider what our culture thinks of evil. And when I say culture, you can look at any sort of cultural product to see how it's been represented. So I want to look at popular film for a moment. And if you look at depictions of evil in popular film over the last 100 years, you might see some of these examples. Perhaps. So consider what we have. We have Dracula. We have the Wicked Witch of the West. We have Freddy Krueger from the Nightmare on Elm Street series. We have Darth Vader, and we have He Who Shall Not Be Named from the Harry Potter series. But I want you to consider, if this is a fairly interesting, diverse, but representative, perhaps, collection of evil from popular film, what do they all have in common? None of them are human. And that's fascinating, isn't it? None of them. Dracula, vampire, undead, not human. Wicked Witch, not human. Freddy Krueger, certainly not human. Voldemort, no. But Vader's an interesting one. Because I would argue that the only time that Darth Vader is humanized is when he is literally and figuratively unmasked, which is an interesting thing. And so this immediately suggests that this is how we react. This is how we perceive of evil. Evil is something that's perpetrated by monsters. Of course it is. And that's why when we hear about a murderer, a rapist, we immediately go there. We think, oh, this is a monstrous individual. This is a monster. And I want to suggest that this is a very dangerous tendency on our part for at least two reasons. One is, it's much more terrifying to admit the possibility that evil is something that's perpetrated by perfectly ordinary people. And if you admit that possibility, the second worrying fact is that that ordinary person might well be you. And so I think it's important for us to psychologically distance ourselves from the potential that in fact we are dealing with ordinary human behavior. And in fact, is evil itself ordinary? So the question of what is evil, again, as I said, is amorphous. And I refuse to talk about a topic as important and as potent and as disturbing as this and sanitize it. So there are a few disturbing images you're going to see, but this is what I mean when I talk about evil. And let's not try and look away. To me, this is evil. Getting a man to dig his own grave, getting him to forcing him to sit at the edge of it, shooting a bullet through his head so his body falls into it. I would refer to this as evil. I would certainly refer to this as evil. Shooting a woman who's trying to harbor a child, such that the bullet goes through and kills the child as well. And of course, deporting 6 million Jews to their certain deaths. All of this, I think, again, it's subjective, But this is where I would certainly set the bar below this. Now, when we talk about evil, it's also interesting to talk about the individuals who perpetrate actions that might be regarded as evil. This is a good example. This is Rudolf Hess, the commandant at Auschwitz, one of the most notorious death camps during the Nazi regime. And I raise his example because he was famous for a couple of things. One was doing what he did at the camp, but ending up going to his home, which lived at the his family lived at the edge of within the borders of Auschwitz, and being a good family man and a wonderful father. And you think, how can you deal with this tension, where an individual is perpetrating atrocities during the day and they come home in the evening and they're a wonderful person? And this is where, again, I'm trying to urge you to move away from the overly simplistic notion that evil is simply something that's perpetrated by monsters. It's more sophisticated than that. And in the case of Hess, well, he comes to Auschwitz and his big drive is, of course, greater efficiency. This is going to be a disturbing example. But when he gets there, they are already killing people by firing squad. And if you visit Auschwitz today, you'll see this wall and you can see fragments of the bullets embedded within the wall. But Hess wants to make it more efficient. There's a war effort going on. They can't waste bullets. And so then they use a different technique. He puts together the heads of as many prisoners as he can and sees how many he can kill with a single bullet. In his mind, this is efficiency. But he still doesn't want to waste the bullets. And so then they start using gas vans, where they push 40 to 50 people into the back of a van, drive around for 20 minutes and route the exhaust in, and they die via carbon monoxide poisoning. But there's a war effort on and we can't waste fuel. And then, of course, they move to gas chambers. 200 people. You steal every one of their belongings. You even shave their heads because you're going to use their hair to stuff pillowcases. You even extract the gold filling from their teeth. You promise them that they're going to go in for a shower. And there are shower heads, but they're never going to be used. Because as soon as the door is shut, of course, someone is pressing a button. And that someone is never going to see their victims, which is an important component, of course. And as soon as they press the button, 200 men, women, and children will see a gas canister fall from the ceiling. And the gas they used was Zyklon B gas. It's a very heavy gas. And one of the issues with that is that it starts at the bottom and it makes its way up. So one of the most horrifying things to consider, of course, is who dies first. It's the little ones. And then as people are clambering away to try and get away from the rising poison, you end up with this pyramid of bodies. I don't want to stare away from this. Evil is worthy of study. It's the only way we can hope to understand it and inhibit it. But the worst picture I've ever seen is not a picture of blood or gore or human remains. It's a picture of a wall. It's a wall inside a gas chamber at Auschwitz. And it's a wall in which you see lots of vertical lines. Except you realize that these are not just vertical lines. These are people who are trying to claw their way out from concrete with their bare fingernails. And there's no way we can possibly understand what this experience is. I hope we never can. But it's important that we understand, try to, not just their experience, but also the mindset of those who created that experience. It's a difficult subject. But let's move to another leading Nazi. The study of evil, I know there's some political philosophers in the room, is surely incomplete without talking about Adolf Eichmann, who was, of course, responsible for implementing much of the final solution as in charge of the transportation network. Eichmann, like so many leading Nazis, managed to escape Europe. In his case, the International Red Cross unwittingly aided his exit. This is his fake passport, by the way. He went under the name Ricardo Clement, and he escaped. And it was only years later, the State of Israel has been founded. Of course, one of their tasks, especially for the Mossad, is to track down some of the leading Nazis who'd managed to evade capture. And they don't know where he is. And it's only years, years, years later that they hear a rumor that there's someone who looks like it might be Eichmann, potentially, is living in Buenos Aires in Argentina. And so they put together a crack team. They fly to Argentina in the middle of the night without the permission of the Argentinian government, which caused a separate set of problems. They identify him. They kidnap him. They take him back to Israel. And they give Eichmann what he never gave his victims, the benefit of a full trial. And while the trial is taking place in Jerusalem, there's an American political philosopher, famous by the name of Hannah Arendt. And she really wants to get to know Eichmann because, well, if this man did what people said he did, he is evil, or at least the actions that he perpetrated might be referred to as evil. And she wanted to understand the mindset. So she interviewed him for weeks. And of course, by the end, he was found guilty. The evidence was overwhelming. And in fact, it's interesting, he remains the only person put to death by Israel in a civilian court. But at the end of all of this, she publishes a book. The book, of course, is Eichmann in Jerusalem. And it's funny, but the subtitle, or part of the subtitle of this book, has become almost synonymous with the book itself because it provided a bit of a provocative idea at the time. And it's the phrase, the banality of evil. Because Arendt, she, after interviewing Eichmann, felt that he was an uninspired bureaucrat, a mere cog in the wheel, that he wasn't a passionate, fervent Nazi, that he was just, the only thing he was passionate about was his career in his in her book. So she thought that if he's capable of these actions, then surely anyone is. And that's why the banality of evil, that anything that's banal is normal, it's ordinary, it's mundane, and think of evil as mundane. Of course, as I said, it's a frightening concept. What's interesting over here as well is that although she may have been quite wrong about Eichmann, in fact, there's quite a bit of evidence that he was quite passionate. This is an individual who directly disobeyed orders from Himmler to go lightly on the Jews at the end in hopes that they might be treated more leniently by the Allies and instead marched 600,000 Hungarian Jews to their deaths. He was passionate. But even if she was wrong about him, she's not wrong in general. The fundamental idea of evil itself being banal is something that's been explored over and over again. These are two particularly famous books that have explored and argued this case. Evil is banal, and we're not talking about instigators, we're talking about perpetrators. We're talking about the people who carry out the genocide in this particular case. So what does psychology have to say? Well, certainly a lot. But as a social psychologist, there's at least one classic study I feel I would be amiss if I didn't refer to. It's a study that many of you probably have heard about. There's a movie, a new movie that's coming out about it as well. In 1961, social psychologist named Stanley Milgram decided to study obedience and investigate the particular role that obedience played in the behaviors of the perpetrators. And this is at Yale University in the United States. He posted this advertisement in a local newspaper, paying, in today's dollars, it would be about $35 or so for an hour of people's time. And he says it's a study of memory. Imagine you sign up. Now imagine you are a participant in this particular study. You come in, you meet, let's say, me in a white lab coat. Right? I greet you and I say, welcome. There's another participant who's waiting here as well, and now that you're both here, we can get going. As you know, this is a study about memory. Many people, including parents, use punishment, of course, as a way to motivate their children to learn. But from a scientific point of view, we actually don't know how effective this is as a technique. So we need to explore this. So what we're going to do is one of you is going to be a teacher. The other one is going to be a learner. We're going to do this by random draw. So we've got two chits of paper. One of them says teacher. The other one says learner. I'm going to shake them in my hand, and you grab one, and the other person grabs the other, and you report what you say. Now, of course, this is rigged because there's only one real participant. The other one is an actor who's appearing to be a real participant. It's also rigged because both chits of paper say teacher. So even though the real participant is insured that they'll say, oh, I'm a teacher, the other one's going to lie and say, oh, I'm a learner. It's set up, and this is crucial, to be believable that this is purely by chance. I could have just as easily been in the other person's position. And then, of course, you're separated. The learner is going to be strapped in to a shock generator. Their task is to pay attention, learn as many of the word pairs as they possibly can. You're going to read a sequence of words that are paired together. And when you get to the end of your list, you go back to the beginning and you read the first half of the first pair. You give them a multiple choice question. And if they get it right, fantastic, you move on. But if they get it wrong, and I have a feeling they're going to get a few wrong, you have to deliver an electric shock. And this is, of course, the wonderful machine that you have to use. It looks fairly innocuous at the beginning. It's simply a 15-volt shock. It's not extremely powerful. And in fact, you're given a sample shock to get a taste as well. But you start at 15 volts. If they happen to make a second mistake, the rule is you have to move up by one. You can't repeat the same number. And each button goes up by another 15 volts. You go from 15 to 30 to 45 and so on. But let's imagine that somebody manages to keep going all the way to 150 volts. Along the way, you're going to hear a lot of yelling. The yelling is going to get louder. Now, of course, you should know by now, by virtue of the fact that the other person was an actor, that nobody was actually receiving a shock. But it was entirely believable. There were pre-recorded and rather blood-curdling yells that were played at each sequence. The question, of course, of all of this is, what percentage of ordinary individuals would be willing to harm a complete stranger to the tune of, all the way at the end, 450 volts, simply at the behest of a person in a white lab coat who says, you must continue. The experiment requires that you continue. The power of authority. That's what Milgram was interested in exploring. And before Milgram actually conducted this experiment, he actually went to three groups of people and he said, this is what I'm planning on doing. He went to students at Yale University, he went to people in the community, and he went to a group of psychiatrists at Male Yedical School. Yeah. It was a male Yedical School, but Yale Medical School. But you think psychiatrists know a thing or two about human behavior, but the odd thing is all three groups came up with the same response. They were asked, what percentage of people do you think would go all the way? All three groups say, 1 to 2%. And that might be your estimate as well. If you're thinking monster, if you're thinking people who enjoy harming other people, people who have sadistic tendencies. And yes, if you start to look at things like antisocial personality disorder, what might be informally referred to as psychopathy, you are talking about a very small fragment of the population. And this is the experiment, of course, that, if you'll pardon the pun, shocked the world, because, of course, it was much more than that. This is the shock machine again. And if you see, it's hard to see, really, but the numbers are atop. At the bottom, there's language. In case it wasn't perfectly obvious, it starts by saying mild shock, strong shock, severe shock. All the way at the end, it actually says danger, XXX. So, you know, it's almost cartoonish, but again, 1 to 2%, the wrong answer, 65%, right? 65% of people with no particular history willing to go along. It's not like they were enjoying it. We need to pull back from the fundamental attribution error again, assuming that their behavior is coming from within them. It's not. It's the power of the situation, a situation that's hard to understand, a situation that's easy to underestimate in terms of its power. But even though this is true, two-thirds of the average person goes all the way to 450 volts and keeps pressing 450 volts until you stop them, there were other conditions. And this is where you really see how dramatic the power of the situation is. There was one particular version of the experiment in which Milgram allowed his participants a lot more flexibility. It was the same thing. Remember the words, try and get them right, and if you get them wrong, you're going to get an electric shock. But instead of giving the specific instruction that you need to start at 15 and work your way up by one, he said, here's a shock machine. You have to give them a shock. It's up to you. Use any level. Repeat it if you like. It's totally up to you. Much more flexibility. And what's the obedience rate there? 2.5%. That's what I mean about underestimating the power of the situation. It's virtually the same, apart from that one instruction. But the shock level is dramatically lower. And yet another condition, in which the participants were still the teacher, but they were one of two teachers. And all they had to do was check to see if the answers were right or wrong. They never had to press the button. Pressing the button was the task assigned to another person. And when that was the case, you think the participant is effectively a bystander at this point. They're involved. So perhaps they're more than a bystander. But for the worst part of the job, they are effectively a bystander. And that's the condition in which you have, in fact, 92.5% obedience. So I think, you know, the simple answer to this is, yes, most people can do what you would be surprised that they would do, what they themselves would not dream of doing normally under the wrong circumstances. But depending on what the specific circumstances are, things can look a lot better, things can look a lot worse. And this is yet another illustration of how easy it is to underestimate the power of this particular toxic situation. It's interesting. In 2007, there was a researcher who at Santa Clara University in California who managed, with a slightly changed procedure, but effectively the same, to replicate this study. And of course, everyone was curious in the field to see what would happen, because surely we live in an enlightened age, right? But no, the obedience rate was precisely the same as it was in 1961. So I'm talking a lot about the power of the situation, but I do want to make this broader point as well, is that even though the situation is powerful, this is not to say that everyone reacts the same within the situation. Even Stanley Milgram saw this. He saw that particular tendencies, whether it was being reliable, dutiful, responsible, whether it was being agreeable, or whether it was simply valuing tradition and conformity, all of these things predicted a greater degree of obedience. And that's a broad and general lesson that social psychology has had for a long time. It's not just the situation, it's not just the person, it's usually an interaction between the two. People choose certain situations in some cases. In other cases, people leave situations if they want to. But more than anything, situations affect different people in different ways. And that's a fairly straightforward point, I think. So let's talk about this situation. A little more familiar to us, perhaps. A few years ago, the Vancouver Stanley Cup riots, version 2.0. And I love this, the Georgia Strait asking this question, is this normal? It's excellent. And of course, what do you mean by normal? Again, right? If we're talking about ordinary people doing terrible things, then yes, it would be fairly normal. But perhaps what we need to do is zoom out a bit, because what we're looking at over here is a perpetrator, perhaps an instigator, but certainly a perpetrator. But when you zoom out, you see more context. Perhaps there was planning, perhaps there were instigators who would have done or initiated what they wanted to do anyway, but there were many more perpetrators than there were instigators. And you can wonder about the power of the situation on the perpetrators. You can wonder about that. People whose history would indicate nothing, would predict nothing along these lines. That might be the power of the situation. But of course, if the flame that you're really seeing over here are the actions of the perpetrators, I would suggest that the oxygen that allows the flame to burn itself is the inaction of the bystanders. And that's a variable that's not often discussed, the implicit condoning of what's happening by smiling, photographing faces. So again, when I'm trying to understand evil, I'm trying to understand it at several levels. And I think if you zoom into the notion of monsters, you're typically describing people who might be instigators of genocide. When you're talking about perpetrators, you're talking about people who very often have mixed motives, who shift, but who are very much succumbing to the power of the situation. And then, of course, bystanders themselves, believing that they are neutral, but of course, the last thing they are is neutral. Right? That's not neutral. So let's come back to talking about broader forces and genocide. Because when we look at groups, the way we look at the world, one thing that's very easy for us is to categorize the world. We look at people, we look at different groups, and we're easily able to categorize people into the most salient categories. That's where you can talk about race, for example. It's very easy for us. It's very natural for us to do this. But when we do this, of course, we end up making a few inferences, a few assumptions along the way. One is, if you'll notice, all the people inside the circle are smiling. That's us, by the way. That's what we call the in-group. That's us. Everyone outside the circle, that's them. Okay, that's them. And them, well, you'll notice that them, they are a lot more homogenous than we are. Have you ever noticed that? Your group is readily recognized as heterogeneous. You see great diversity. You think about, oh, what are Canadians like? Oh, wonderfully diverse, right? You think about people from Newfoundland and Alberta and Yukon and BC and all over BC. You think this is just incredibly diverse we are as a people. Canadian culture is such a beautiful, diverse creation. And then you think, what are Americans like? And you think, oh, well, they're all the same. Right. So it's interesting. They're more homogenous, but it's not just neutral either. Because there's, you'll say, oh yes, there's the exception to the rule. I have no idea who your exception wants to be tonight. It always mortifies me when people say Oprah in my class, but still. But the point is two things. One is they are homogeneous, we are heterogeneous. The other thing is, of course, we are smiling and they are frowning, because the comparison is always in our favor. And it doesn't matter what metric you use. You can ask people which group is more intelligent, more peaceful, more fun, more sexually attractive. It doesn't matter. It's always the in-group. It's us better than them. But this is natural. This is an everyday. This is how we think. This is how we operate. But when we talk about genocide, of course, we're talking about forces that operate much more broadly, that have historical, political, cultural significance. So imagine for a moment, knowing this, what it's like to grow up in 1933 Germany. Right? The Nuremberg laws have been passed, which identify very clearly who us is and who them is. Very clearly. And it doesn't matter whether you think you're Jewish or not. It doesn't matter. This chart will tell you if you're Jewish or not. In fact, your grandparents might have been Jewish, and perhaps in their lives they converted to Catholicism. But Jewishness is something that the Nazis believed was in your blood, and it's not something you can get rid of. So in fact, you could be a bishop of the Catholic Church, and you would still be Jewish. And that's not a difficult example. There were bishops of the Catholic Church who were inmates at concentration camps because they were deemed Jewish. So it's made very salient, made very clear, and even more salient by, of course, the edict that all Jews have to wear this yellow Star of David on their arms or face harsh consequences. So you grow up here. This is your normal life. And you hear this from your teachers. You read this in your textbooks. You see this in posters. You see this in movies. You read about it in books. This is what you know, that this is us and this is them. And of course, when I say us, this is us. This is the in-group. This is wonderful propaganda saying this is the in-group. This is the tall, strapping, salt of the earth, blonde-haired, blue-eyed Aryan. Right? Of course, few think for a moment to think that, well, the leader of the entire movement is, I suppose, a slight exception. Small, physically unimpressive, high-pitched, squeaky voice, just strange guy. Marginal, really. Not even German, he's Austrian. Anyway, but that's us. Who's them? Look at the propaganda. So this is more than just looking at the outgroup as homogenous. It's more than just favoring the in-group. This is dehumanization, systematically, and over years and years and years. The eternal Jew, they will never change. Lots of propaganda. Very effective propaganda. Jews are described as vermin, as bacilli, as vultures, as those who stabbed us in the back and caused Germany to lose World War I. This is where scapegoating begins. So, I talked earlier about us versus them. But when you see dehumanization like this, you need to add a new layer. Because us is in fact us, when I say good people. I suppose in a Canadian context, in some quarters, this might be referred to as old stock Canadians. Then you broaden, and you say, then there's them. That's other people. And for the Nazis, that might be the British, the Americans. They're on the other side, but they're people. But then, of course, you have the dehumanized group, the group that's scapegoated, and that's not people. These are people who are outside of your moral universe. And different rules apply when you start thinking about them in this fashion. And when I talk about propaganda that depicted Jews in this fashion, that's not an exception. You can look at the Rwandan genocide and how Tutsis were described as cockroaches. There's lots of examples. But I want to try a little exercise with you. Let's say, as I'm talking right now, with these wonderful lights, I see a mosquito that's flying close to me. I don't like mosquitoes. I'm slightly paranoid about the West Nile virus, so I smash it. I've killed the mosquito. And I'm genuinely asking you, show of hands, how many of you think I've done something immoral at this point? I'm so glad I have most of you with me. Most of you. Okay. But let's say it's not a mosquito. Let's say it's a cockroach. Cockroach is not going to bite me. I just find it somewhat disgusting. And so I actually take a couple of steps out of my way, and I smash it. Immoral? Really? Wow. Okay. Okay. I'm trying to picture what your homes look like. But let's take it further. Let's say science world is having a really bad week, and there's a rat that emerges from underneath that curtain. Right? And I pick up one of these glasses, and I fling it in its direction. And because cricket is just such a superior game to baseball, really? Wow. Thank you. Didn't think that would be it. So I managed to hit the rat squarely on its head. I didn't intend to do this. I meant to frighten it, but I ended up killing it. It lands on its head. The rat is bleeding onto this carpet. It's disgusting. Immoral?
Yes.
Wow. I love that I still have some of you saying, no, that's fine. That's great. But what if somebody quietly, surreptitiously brought in a feline? What if there's a cat that manages to emerge from its owner's clutches? It runs to the front and it starts mewing incessantly and the owner's chasing it, trying to quieten it. But of course, it's a cat, so you're staff, effectively. So I get enraged and I pick up a chair and I fling it in its direction. I kill the cat. In a fit of rage, I've murdered a cat in front of you. Unethical? Okay. What about a dog? That would be far worse, wouldn't it? Yeah, far, far worse. Yeah. Okay. But see, the point is, different rules apply. And even though this is funny, it's not funny, because if you think about growing up in 1933 Germany and receiving that propaganda everywhere, it's what you believe. It plays on a natural tendency and it takes it just a little bit further. So when you're given an instruction as part of a job that you can easily justify to take a weapon and do one of the things you saw in the earlier photographs, it's fine, because in fact they are not human. Different rules apply in a different moral universe, and that boundary is very, very dangerous. Now, having said that, this is not something that happens very quickly. It happens in stages. The first law that came out for prohibiting the activities of Jews during the build-up to the Holocaust was in fact prohibiting Jews from sitting on park benches. And it seems fairly benign. It seems like the sort of level that people would say, well, that seems wrong, but nobody's getting hurt, so I can live with that. And now you're pressing the 15-volt button, which is fine. But of course, each sequence takes you only a slight step further. This is a very effective technique. In fact, before Jews were targeted in terms of the industrial killing machine, the Nazis targeted those who were physically and mentally disabled. The T4 program. On the left, you're seeing a propaganda poster outlining exactly how much, 60,000 Reichmarks, is what this individual is going to cost the state if they stay alive for the rest of their life. They actually used the phrase, life unworthy of life. And this was part of the program. That shouldn't sound too strange, by the way. We should remind ourselves of things like the Alberta Sterilization Act. But when I talk about subtle changes that change behavior over time, I think people readily acknowledge that personality can influence behavior, but people rarely understand that the behavior and the actions that you undertake can actually begin shaping your personality. So you think about, how would you train an executioner? It's simple, really, isn't it? You'd start by hiring them to guard the outside of the door where the execution's taking place. They need a job. They can easily justify it. They're not involved. They are the 92.5% condition in Milgram's experiment. They're a bystander. And they can justify that, but you get them used to that. A few weeks later, they're guarding the door, but now on the inside. A few weeks later, they're asked to bring you a piece of equipment in the middle of an execution. A few weeks later, you ask them to hold down the individual who's being executed while you do the task. A couple of weeks later, they are the executioner. It's subtle. And this is what Irvin Staub, a very famous genocide study scholar, refers to as the continuum of destruction. Our small actions, in fact, increase our proclivity in that particular direction. And it's interesting, you can start off by viewing a particular action as entirely immoral, but if you progress sufficiently down this continuum, you can start to justify it. You can say, well, it's not good, but there's a reason, there's a higher purpose, and you're in. But if you progress all the way to the end, you see a very interesting reversal of morality, to the point where the action that was presently justifiable or initially immoral is now, in fact, a moral imperative. Imagine going to a point where the action is now, you would be unethical if you didn't do it. And that's the end point of the continuum of destruction. This is precisely what the Nazi doctors describe. Famous book by Robert J. Lifton, in which he interviewed many of these people. These are individuals who perpetrated atrocities that are far worse than anything that happened in any gas chamber. But even they describe it in this fashion. At first, it was impossible. But by the end, it became routine. That's the only way to describe it. And you think about the socialization into killing. Again, this challenges our narrative of it being monsters responsible for evil. It's ordinary people, the power of the situation, harnessing forces and tendencies we already have in terms of distinguishing between in and out groups. Dehumanization, and then slow, gradual changes that take you down the continuum of destruction. It's perfectly ordinary. As another example, I want you to consider these three statements. The first one is what's commonly known as the Nuremberg defense, but this actually comes from research by Kristen Monroe, who interviewed perpetrators from the Holocaust and asked why they did what they did. They say, I had no choice. I was just following orders. Sure. And then you ask bystanders the same question. Why did you do what you did or not do what you ought to have done? And they say, well, you have to accept it. There was nothing to do. You couldn't do anything. No choice. And then, of course, you ask rescuers, people who've actually risked their life to save people, why did you do what you did? And this stuns me. I have to help those in need. There is no choice. Nobody perceives choice, which is fascinating to me. Everybody has choice, of course. Perpetrators have choice. Rescuers certainly have choice, and bystanders absolutely have choice. But either the way in which they've graduated allows them to perceive the world in a way that inhibits their choice, or perhaps this is simply how they're justifying their action or inaction. But the absence of choice is a stunning development. So that's not the only parallel between perpetrators and rescuers. And this sounds really odd, but I'm going to suggest that there are several psychological processes that underlie the behavior of the best of humanity and the worst of humanity that are actually virtually the same. We're not talking about radically different things. With perpetrators, you see many of these things, some of which I've talked about. When we talked about dehumanization, that's effectively what we call moral exclusion. They're in a separate moral universe now. Same rules do not apply. We know from research in early childhood that exposure to destructive models, in fact, increases this propensity. We know that a charismatic leader, you could look at Hitler as a charismatic leader as one example, can set the norms of a group so that even conformity drives people to comply with what the broader forces are doing. And we've talked about the continuum of destruction. When you get to that end point where not perpetrating an atrocity makes you unethical, well, that's fanaticism. Those are the true believers who get to the very end of the continuum of destruction. But when you consider the behavior of rescuers, you see moral inclusion. And it's not a different process. The only thing that's different is where exactly the circle is drawn. And so you can look at examples like this. This woman with her husband, who saved many Jews in Albania during the Holocaust. And when interviewed, she says, no, there are no foreigners in Albania. There are only guests. Or King Christian X in Denmark. Great example. Poland and many other countries lost, and I say lost, they saw 90% of their Jewish population murdered. Denmark saw 92% of their Jewish population survive. It's unusual. And part of that happens because of the culture. And part of that happens because they define themselves not by ethnicity, but by nationality. And that's an important process. Where do you draw the line that ends up being inclusion or exclusion? You can talk about helpful models, charismatic leaders, group norms once again. A good example, in Vichy, France, there was a small village called Le Chambon. And they had many, many Jewish families. And they go to the head of their village, who is a Protestant minister, and they say, what do we do? And he says, if you are going to do your duty as a Christian, you need to save the Jews in our village. He defines it as such. He's charismatic. And now it's conformity. You do not assume that everyone in there is a passionate believer in human rights. No. It could be subtle, silly reasons, like feeling embarrassed if you're not doing what everybody else is doing. But every time the Gestapo come to arrest the Jewish families, they're not there. They've been hidden in the forest behind the village with enough food and water for days and days and days. The Gestapo keep coming back over the entire period that France is occupied. They never find them. All of them survived. It's incredible. A charismatic leader can be good, it can be bad. And fanaticism can be good or bad. And it sounds strange to say that. But just as you have the continuum of destruction, you have the continuum of benevolence. Imagine you're walking down a street in Frankfurt. It's 1943. You're Aryan. You're minding your own business. You're walking along. There's nobody else there. And in the distance, you see a young woman running in your direction. And she has a panicked expression on her face. And as she gets close to you, you can see she's terrified. You have no idea what's going on. But as she goes around you, she whispers. She says, "Please don't tell them where I'm going." You have no idea what she's talking about. Who's they? And she disappears. 2 minutes later, you see a troop of SS officers marching down the street. And they stop you and they say, "Have you seen anyone walking here?" And you don't have an hour to think about this. And you, later you might think, "Why did I say that?" But on the spur of the moment, you say, "Well, no." And you're not sure why you said that. It was a spur of the moment thing. But doing that makes you more likely to agree to look after the property of a neighbor who's Jewish, who's being deported. Doing that makes you more likely to agree to conceal the child of a neighbor in your attic, a la Anne Frank. Doing that takes you further. And this is the continuum of benevolence. It's a wonderful parallel, and there are lots of examples of it. One of the most famous rescuers of Jews during the Holocaust, Oskar Schindler. Not a guy who you would have predicted would have been in that position. Member of the Nazi Party, war profiteer, alcoholic womanizer. And you think of all the people, he's not going to be your top pick. But he starts by saving, you know, pulling strings, wheeling and dealing, saving a couple of people who mattered to him. And that led him to go further and further and further to the point where he actually became fanatical about it. He breaks down at the end, realizing that I could have sold my car and saved one more Jew. I could have sold my suit and saved one more Jew. That's a radical transformation. And it's a similar transformation that we see in the case of Paul Rusesabagina. You've probably seen the movie Hotel Rwanda. It's based on his life. Again, wheeling, dealing, manipulating manager of the Hotel Mille Collines in Kigali. But he's married to a person in the group that's being targeted. And he starts by trying to save his family and then expanding and expanding. And by the end of it, in his book, his autobiography, again, which is titled An Ordinary Man, of course, he talks about this transformation. He saves 1,200 people. So again, nobody wakes up one day and becomes a monster. Nobody wakes up one day and is Mother Teresa. It's gradual evolution. And that's why I like this image so much. How many of you see demons? Some of you do. But if you look at it differently, you see angels, don't you? Angels and demons coexisting. And this is the narrative I'm trying to challenge. This is a wonderful illustration by the graphic artist M.C. Escher. And to me, it really illustrates human nature, because even though we really want to separate the world into good people and bad people, that's not how it works. We have both tendencies. And in fact, in many cases, it is exactly the same psychological process that's underlying the behavior of perpetrators and of rescuers, which sounds like a blasphemous thing to say. But it's closer to the complexity of the truth. But that's just perpetrators and rescuers. And you are neither of them. I am neither of them. We are, in fact, bystanders. And in thinking about what a bystander's role is, this is the poem I keep coming back to. It's one of the best, most evocative summaries of what the experience of a bystander is. This is Pastor Martin Niemöller, Protestant, who in fact was imprisoned in a concentration camp towards the end of the war for opposing Nazi policies. He writes, "First, they came for the socialists, and I did not speak out because I was not a socialist. Then they came for the trade unionists, and I did not speak out because I was not a trade unionist. Then they came for the Jews, and I did not speak out because I was not a Jew. And then they came for me. And of course, then there was no one left to speak." I'm talking about bystanders because that's what we are. Many of my students like to believe that Canada as a nation is peaceful, is welcoming, embraces multiculturalism. And when you see images and you hear stories of how Syrian refugees are being treated right now, you react with a revolt, perhaps. And you think, this is not who we are, but in fact, this is precisely who we are. This poster was between the First and Second World War. And yes, we're talking about Penticton, BC. Let's not forget how we treated Japanese Canadian citizens during the Second World War. And this is again here, New Westminster, Port Coquitlam, Port Moody. Let's not forget how those on the Komagata Maru were greeted and the Continuous Journey Act, which essentially made it impossible. Let's not forget the Chinese head tax. Let's please not forget how Canada received Jewish refugees during the Second World War. When the minister in charge was asked about how many Jews Canada would admit, that's what he said. None is too many. Let's not forget residential schools in this country, the last of which closed in 1996. Let's not forget about missing and murdered First Nations women. Let's not forget about any of this. Because when it comes to all of these things, we are the bystanders. We are supplying the oxygen that allows all of this to happen. And the way we react to images like this should horrify you. But all of the previous ones should horrify you equally. But please know, as we see changes in our political landscape, that what we have seen is perfectly, extraordinarily consistent with how this country has treated people in the past. I want to finish with something a little more uplifting. And it's a story that goes back to the first thing, or one of the first things I talked about. At the start, I talked about the paradox of social psychology. How the power of the situation is immense and often invisible, but yet the individual within the situation has the ability to redefine the situation for everybody, to puncture that balloon. And this is one of those stories. It's a true story. A very dear friend of mine is a child survivor of the Holocaust. He grew up in Hungary. This is not his story. This is the story of his aunt and uncle. His aunt and uncle were musicians, talented musicians. And they were traveling, at the time the Nazis invaded Hungary, they were traveling in Turkey as part of a large orchestra. So they're in Turkey and they realize, of course, there's no way they can go back. And so they try to find where they can possibly go in the world that might be safe. And of all places they manage to figure out, they end up deciding, we can find safe passage, we can get to India. Okay? But the world is a little more complicated. In order to get to India, overland, they have to travel over China. China happens to be occupied by Japan. So these Hungarian musicians in Turkey go to the Japanese consulate in Ankara, requesting a transit visa to cross over Japanese-occupied China to get to India. Are you with me so far? And the consular official looks at them and says, I absolutely understand where you're coming from. I understand your plight. I wish I could help you. But my government, the Japanese government, has given me express orders not to provide a transit visa to anyone who wants to go to enemy territory. Enemy territory? Of course, India was occupied by the British at the time. So, as I said, you have Hungarian musicians in Turkey requesting permission from Japanese consular official to cross over Japanese-occupied China to get into British-occupied India. It's very painful, but this is true. And he says, I wish I could help you, but my hands are tied. And then he says, however, if I was going to issue you with a transit visa, this is the stamp I would put in your passport. And would you please excuse me? I need to go to the washroom for 10 minutes. My friend's uncle reached across, used the stamp, stamped both of their passports. They made it. They survived. Again, you can talk about the power of the situation. But the beauty of this is that the individual redefined it. They found a way. And that's what I usually hope that my students take away from this class as well, is many times when we talk about genocide, human rights, it feels like the problem is immense, far too immense to try and even begin to grapple with. But let us not let the enormity of the problem paralyze us into inaction. we can move from bystanders to rescuers. And we owe it to the future of this country to do so. Thank you for your attention.
Very compelling talk. I'm sure many of you have questions. So if you put up your hand, we have people with microphones who will come to you. And if you please try to keep your questions brief, then we can entertain more of them.
Go ahead. Hi.
Hey.
As I'm pretty sure you know, I'm a former student of Rajiv's. I grew up in the American South. What do you do about that one Mississippi uncle on Facebook who wants to still fly the Confederate flag and, you know, hates immigrants and so on and so forth? How do I use my, you know, to me it's not just good enough that I'm good or, you know, being a good person, but how do I use who I am to influence someone else to come a little bit further down that continuum of benevolence rather than the continuum of destruction that they're currently on?
Thanks, Tierney. Gosh, there's so many things. I think for one, you may not have as big of an issue on Facebook as it might be, and that's simply because Facebook's algorithms are going to supply you with more things that you like than you dislike. But other than the manipulation that's happening from their end, one thing I think people naturally want to do is get into arguments and try and provide rational, logical arguments for people to say, this is why you're wrong. You know, concrete reasons not to believe what you believe. But of course, what we certainly know is that when you have what social psychologists refer to as motivated social cognition, people are deliberately going to pay attention to information and evidence that supports that supports what they already believe. So people pay attention to evidence that confirms what they believe. They're less likely to pay attention to or believe evidence that refutes it. So it's an immense challenge broadly. The other issue is when you talk about how do you move this individual through the continuum of benevolence, I'm sure in their mind they're very much midway up that stream, right? And that's the trick over here, is everyone thinks that they're a good person at the end of the day, right? And so that's the challenge. So I suppose this is not going to help in terms of attitude change, but one might easily use an example of this in this case to unpack some of the reasons that underpin their reasoning and use that for other people. But in terms of trying to change their mind, it's a losing cause. I certainly wouldn't waste as much energy doing that. No, I wouldn't unfollow them. I think engaging with people is a useful exercise, if at the very least to explain why this person holds this opinion for other people, or to understand some of the antecedents of their position, to try and recognize it and use that information for other people. But I mean, the main point you're asking is, how do I change this person's way of thinking? And it's really, really difficult to do that. Confirmation bias makes that very difficult. So, yeah. Question over here, Victor.
Thank you. Hi. I'm just wondering if normalizing violence towards the others is how you get people to a place where they can help you in your agenda. Has there ever been a situation in history where someone has gone in and tried to change the perception of a culture in order to prevent a genocide?
Well, you know, I think over the last 20 years or so, there's been a fair amount of work in cultures that have already experienced violence. So Rwanda, South Africa, many other places. And they work very actively to try and create a culture which reduces the likelihood of these events recurring. One of the things they do very systematically is try and remove salient reminders of divisions between the groups within the culture. Another thing they do is to try and get what's often referred to as a superordinate goal. You get different groups to work together towards a higher purpose that matters to all of them, and that their future livelihoods all depend on. I mean, people often talk about education as the way out, and I wish it was. So I don't think that's necessarily the most effective way. But I think many of the causal and precipitating factors when it comes to broader violence like this are things that are difficult to stave off. You're talking about loss, shame, humiliation at a cultural level. Scapegoating is more likely to happen when you have a minority that lives apart, that's not especially integrated. Of course, that didn't save Jews who were integrated in Europe. So it's a difficult question you're asking, but I think work at the moment focuses on taking away divisions, on getting groups to work together systematically, on education, particularly starting at the kindergarten and elementary school level. But in many cases, this is still an exercise, an experiment in progress. And we don't have great models for how to inhibit this kind of violence within a society. We're hoping for the best. But even when I speak and work with people from Rwanda, for example, despite all the work that's been done with the community courts and sort of decentralized justice at a more relatable level, they still tell me that it feels like it can happen again tomorrow. So I don't have a great answer for you. But that's why I suppose there's a couple of things. One is, I think, you know, again, the issue of not letting the enormity of the problem not let you do anything. Because there's many small things we can do that make tangible differences to people's lives, whether it's refugees, in temporary situations, or something else. But the other nice benefit, of course, is the change in us. Is as we engage with this, as we try and reach out, as we try and help, fundraise, work with groups, try and figure out a way forward, it changes us. And so by engaging with this process elsewhere, we're certainly inhibiting the likelihood of it happening here, if that makes sense. That's not the main goal. It's a collateral goal.
Thank you.
Hi. So I was wondering, you were talking about many scenarios. One where you were born into a benevolent society, and another one where you were born into an evil society. And whatever you are born into, whatever that happens to be, you have to find, you found people that have act regardless of their scenario. So my question is, would you believe like in a to 0 to 100% that we are born more evil or more benevolent?
It's interesting, isn't it? It's a lot of research in developmental psychology been sort of exploring how are we born in that sense. Is our default to be good or default to not be good? And it's a really mixed bag as far as I can tell. I mean, there's interesting research that looks at, you know, young children who are pre-verbal, who engage in spontaneous, helping, altruistic behavior when they see an adult needing help, for example. It's famous research by Michael Tomasello that looks at that. And he's found similar things with chimpanzees. And so he uses that together to sort of make an argument that at an evolutionary level, we seem to have evolved these mechanisms that allow us to engage naturally, spontaneously, in pro-social behavior. On the other hand, we also see research that challenges that, or at least makes that a little more nuanced. I mean, research here at UBC, for example, which I'm trying to remember the name of the research, oh God, it'll come to me. But young children, again, pre-verbal, when they are, how do I put this? Young children prefer people, adults, who share the same preferences as adults that they like. And conversely, where this starts to get a little bit darker, is young children prefer when those who have different preferences than adults that they like are harmed, oddly enough. This is pre-verbal. So there's a lot of interesting research happening that's trying to get at this question you're asking through different approaches, and I don't think we really know yet, but we are getting different messages that at some point need to be integrated, but I'm not sure they are yet.
Do you agree with the statement that history repeats itself, or do you think that we're becoming more educated and we're becoming better as individuals and as a society? The reason why I'm asking is because there are some people, like the audience today, that are thinking about the terms that you're explaining. They're excited about the topics that you're talking about. However, there are some people who deny the existence of Holocaust. And people like that just astonishes me.
That's the Mississippi uncle I think you've got. But yeah, sorry.
Back to the question.
Yeah.
Do you agree with the statement that history repeats itself, or do you think we're getting better?
Well, I think it's fascinating. I think I would frame it differently, because I'm not a historian, but I am a psychologist. And I would suggest that we are a product, yes, of our evolutionary past. And if the underlying psychological processes that allow us to interpret the world and interact with the world are not changing, then inevitably you'll see history repeating itself. But that's because human beings are human beings. I'm really sorry to say that genocide has been a part of human existence since we have records. Well, I think changes for us is how connected we've become, how much access we have to information. So in some sense, it's harder to claim lack of knowledge. It's harder to claim lack of knowledge of what's happening or consequences as they unravel. But at the same time, as we get more connected, I think what we've failed to do is devise mechanisms that will be effective in inhibiting this kind of violence. And what I'm going to specifically suggest over here is when we turn to, as we often do, the United Nations as our savior in this situation, that's an example of a mechanism that's failed, continues to fail repeatedly by virtue of its design. Even in the former Yugoslavia, when intervention happened, it was NATO, it wasn't the United Nations. So my hope for the future, I suppose, is the evolution of a mechanism that reflects how interconnected we are and that avoids the structure of international intervention being focused on 1950. But to go back to your original question, like I said, I think history may be repeating itself, but it's not because of history, it's because of psychology. Yeah. Well, I think, you know, I wouldn't be teaching this course, I wouldn't be giving this talk unless I had some hope, unless I believed that things could change. And I'll give you a very simple example, and maybe this is a good place to wrap as well. So, students at Kwantlen, just extraordinary. There's self-selection in terms of who signs up for a course on the psychology of genocide. No doubt. This is not an elective that you think, okay, I'll take wine science. That's a very popular elective at UBC, I know, but it's different. And a concrete example, the genocide in Darfur, this is an example of a case where it's been going on endlessly. Hundreds and thousands of people killed. And this United Nations unable to do anything. You've got veto powers. But the students, 35 students at Kwantlen, they decided to do something better. And this is what gives me hope. So during the Holocaust, there were some camps that were restricted just for women. And one of them was a place called Ravensbrück. And some of the women at this camp, they realized that they wouldn't survive. But it's interesting, you think about identity, and as Jewish women, for them, cooking was actually a massive part of their identity. And they thought if they could just write down, if they could get together scraps of charcoal and you know, cloth, and write down their family recipes, even if they don't survive, hopefully the recipes will. That's precisely what happened. And if you visit the Vancouver Holocaust Education Center, which I certainly hope you do, they have a tremendous exhibit right now, you can buy the book. It's called In Memory's Kitchen. And it contains recipes of these women. Terrific Christmas present. But the point I'm trying to make is the students at Kwantlen took some of those recipes, spontaneously held a bake sale at Kwantlen. They supplied copies of the recipes and the backstory to people who came up and donated $2, $3. But of course, when they knew what it was about, they ended up donating more. And on one day, in a spontaneous activity, the students raised something like $1,800 Canadian, ended up sending 17 trucks worth of supplies to refugees from the Darfur crisis who were in the neighboring country. They connected the memory of survivors from a previous genocide to help those who are struggling with one that's ongoing now. And in the process, they themselves were transformed. That's what gives me hope. The little things. Thank you.